Thank you for joining us today, and I'd like to thank our panelists for participating. First of all, let me introduce our panel to you. From my immediate right, I want to introduce Dr. Bamsha Mubasher. He's professor and director of analytics and web analytics at DePaul University. Dr. Mubasher. And then to his right is Dr. Seth Rao. He's the chief executive officer of First Eigen Corporation. It's a predictive analytics company. And then to his right is Krishna Kumar. He's director of services for Adeptia Corporation, which is a data integration and business process software company. Welcome all. So the way we want to structure this program, at least this segment of the program, is to talk a little bit about strategy. But as you all know, when you're putting together strategies, there's a lot of due diligence that you have to undertake before you can begin to take a strategy. And so a couple of those things that are considered due diligence activities are, number one, recognizing what are the challenges you face in putting together a big data strategy. Just knowing those challenges is going to be half the answer. And then once you recognize what those challenges are, what risk do those challenges impose, and what mitigation strategies accompany those risks. And then finally, we want C-level people, department agency heads, and other C-level CIOs and so forth, what questions should they be asking themselves in the development of a big data strategy? So our panel is here to talk about prescriptive measures, but not necessarily to give you an A to Z how to do it. It's things that you must consider when you're putting together a strategy for big data. So without further ado, I guess I'm the guy that runs this. How about this? How about that? So let me open up by saying that big data technologies are maturing to a point in which more organizations are prepared to pilot and adapt big data as a core component of the information management and analytics infrastructure. Big data as a compendium of emerging disruptive tools and technologies is positioned as the next great enabling integrated analytics and many common business scenarios. And as big data winds its way into the enterprise, information technology professionals and business sponsors alike are going to be bumping up against a number of challenges that must be addressed before any big data program can be undertaken. So without further ado, I want to allow Dr. Mubasher to give his opening comment on big data.
Thank you. I want to, so this panel, we're going to be discussing strategies and future trends. I want to focus a little bit more on the future trends side of things and then come back to the idea of strategies. I'd like to start with this infographic that Intel put together. Occasionally they update it, I think, once a year or a couple times a year. So this may not necessarily be the most up-to-date one, but it shows you sort of the amount of data that's being, one, generated, and secondly, transferred across the internet in 1 minute. And you may not see all of the details back there, but I think if you look at some of the details, you see that a lot of this is driven by two things. One is much greater ability to stream large amounts of data. And second, by the ability of users to not actually contribute content, which is kind of the next generation of the web, right? So to web 2.0, so to speak, the social web. So people can, add comments, contribute to blogs, post videos, post songs, music, etc., tweets, and Facebook content, and so on. Just to give you one example of this, 3.3 million pieces of content being contributed on Facebook every minute, right? And all of this information is information that's going to be publicly available and become part of the digital footprint of users. So why is this important? Well, from the company perspective, if you want to be able to target the right piece of information to users, you're going to need to be able to make predictions about what users want or need. Predictive modeling. And the complexity and the increase in the amounts and the types and heterogeneity of the data requires much more sophisticated model and requires integration across a lot of these different types of data, both internally to companies, but potentially outside of companies and from the social web, which comprise part of the digital footprint of users. And from the user perspective, it requires more targeted and personalized kinds of applications that allow them to get to the right piece of information right away. So the problem that I want to talk about a little bit is the idea of predictive user modeling for personalization. And personalization, in my view, and predictive user modeling is going to drive really the next generation of applications that utilize big data. You can see a lot of examples of these, you can keep looking here, things like Netflix, recommendations in Amazon, personalized kinds of feeds on Pandora and other kinds of streaming services. But also for companies who want to target information, they need to be able to sort of leverage all of this data. This is not just in the kind of the consumer world, but also you can imagine applications being developed in government, in nonprofit sector, for example, personalized healthcare or medicine requires the ability to combine data from genomics, from lifestyle profiles, from fitness monitors and so on, to be able to build models that can then be used to try to give recommendations, health recommendations, or possibly diagnoses to users. Smart cities or smart e-government, the ability to be able to access data across lots of different sources and sensors and match that against user profiles and then be able to potentially, or maybe profiles of groups of users, and then be able to target government services and city services. So these are some examples of the kind of things that would be driving. What are the three critical ingredients for large-scale intelligent personalization? Well, one is leveraging big data, and we're going to be talking about that a lot today. The next one is the effective use of analytics. And I would say not just analytics in the sense of doing data analysis, but actually the ability to build predictive models across large heterogeneous data sets. And finally, real-time deployment of predictive models to be able to then target that information in real time to users or to provide services. So very quickly on these three points, the ability to leverage big data, I think one of the biggest advances that we have had in the past few years actually has been in this area of data distillation. Frameworks like Hadoop, for example. Just 5 years ago, we didn't know what to do with all of this data, right? Now you can actually not only touch that data, but actually be able to query, for example, across lots of different text sources, unstructured data, things like what people are saying about a particular topic, what features they're looking at in customer reviews or user reviews, what they're tweeting about and things like that. So this has been a big part of the advance, the ability to deal with structured or semi-structured data and sort of harness it across large data sets. People talk about data being the new oil. Well, big data is kind of like crude oil, right? There's lots of contaminants, a lot of unstructured text, and you need to be able to harness it. The next thing is sort of the ability to build actually this predictive model across that data. You can just kind of look through these. And that's sort of the model building process. And often in these kinds of discussions, we focus a lot on actually collecting the data and maybe pre-processing the data and so on, but not enough on actually what kind of modeling you need to perform. And because of the complexity of the data that we are seeing these days, we need more complex, I wouldn't want to say complex, but more sophisticated kinds of modeling techniques. And finally, the other thing that I want to talk about just briefly is about real-time deployment. And the one part of this that I want to maybe focus on, and it comes back to idea strategies, is that you're not talking about the same kind of a timeline here, right? So the pre-processing, the data distillation part, that's sort of the offline part of the process. At the very bottom, you would have the sort of the real time where the decisions are made when things are basically targeted to a particular user. But there's also this, what I like to call nearline kind of a process, which is somewhere between the offline and the online or the real time components, which involves building the models, but also updating the models, because that needs to happen very quickly, particularly for certain types of real world applications that are going to end users. So I'm going to stop here, and we're going to be talking about some of these aspects there.
Thank you. Thank you. Up next is Dr. Seth Lau.
Thank you, Rich. My name is Seth Rao. I'm the CEO of a predictive data analytics company called Volkswagen. Most companies that we work with typically want to answer, as far as data is concerned, five questions. What happened in my business? Why did it happen? What is happening right now? What's going to happen, and how can I influence it? So the last two parts, what's going to happen and how can we influence it, is a part where First Eigen participates in. So we build predictive models for businesses which are customized. We use open source tools, machine learning tools to build this. We host it and we maintain it. So what my previous panelist talked about was he gave a very quick overview along with Jeff on big data and analytics in general. What I want to do is I want to focus just on the analytics side. I have just a couple of slides here. How is analytics being used in government or local government? Analytics is pretty broadly used in companies. The adoption is increasing a lot more, typically to increase your revenues based on customization or finding out what is it that folks want. Increasing efficiency of your operations or decreasing your costs. The local governments and governments, on the contrary, have not been using data as much, and it's equally applicable. There's been some amount of adoption, and it can be very broadly used in four areas: health and human services, infrastructure, public safety, regulation, and a lot more. And we'll talk a few more of this during the panel discussion. So just setting it up, I wanted to share some examples of what I have seen, how data, big data, and analytics are being used in government. One of our partners worked with a local hospital, a private hospital, to use analytics to improve the efficiency of nurse staffing. Why is that such a big deal? Hospitals have to give their nurses their schedules 4 weeks ahead of time. But here is the problem. They have no idea what the demand is going to look like 12 weeks ahead of time. So what do? They overstaff. And if we could build predictive models that use a lot of external factors and also see historically how things have happened, you could start predicting how the demand can look like. But it's a pretty sophisticated model. And when we did that, we were able to reduce the cost by about 3%. Seems like a small number, but if you take the local hospital in the Cook County area, just the expense, the people, personal expense is more than $500 million. 3% of that adds up very quickly. It's a pretty large number. Analytics, very helpful in making you a lot more efficient. Analytics is also being used to improve utility operations. City of New York worked with MIT, and they were able to build predictive models to see, predict 7 days in advance when failures could happen, when you would have fires in manholes. If you know it ahead of time, saves a lot of time. Philadelphia has used analytics to prevent sewer overflows. You have sensors in different sewers. You'll see how things are happening before they actually begin to happen. New Orleans has used analytics to prevent crime. You could use, again, external factors. You know, how is the weather? Is there a ball game going on? Different neighborhoods, what's happening? you know, you can use traffic patterns, and you can use a lot of external factors to build predictive models that will do a very good job in predicting the future. One of the cities, I think it's Louisville, Kentucky, they increased ambulance response rates to emergencies. Citizens love it. It also saved them $1.4 million over the course of a year. No different than what Southwest does to increase its asset utilization of planes. Similar predictive models to increase the supply chain. City of Chicago already uses analytics to figure out which restaurants are likely to have code violations. City of New York uses analytics predictively to figure out. They increase the productivity of their finance department by 40% using predictive analytics to say, who do I need to audit? This is a very quick overview. Getting predictive analytics, either in the company or in the government, is more like a journey. It's not something you just go buy, pop it in, and game over. It's a lot like a puppy. You get it, you gotta train it, and you gotta remind it once in a while what it needs to be doing. This is typically how people work with analytics, starting with understanding of the problem, and then understanding the data, and then building the model, and then deploying it. And you see there are a lot of feedbacks loops that are out here. And the reason is the models are very specific to specific problems, specific business contexts, and specific companies. So there's a lot of learning that happens. It's not just buy it, fix it, and you're done. And in the panel, I think we'll get to cover a lot more. But the way we are going, lot more data means a lot more analytics is possible.
Now we'd like to have Krishna Kumar give his discussion on data integration.
Thank you, Abhishek.
So what I'm going to be focusing today, again, Krishna Kumar. I work for Adeptia, for an integration software company. We focus on B2B integration, enterprise application integration, business process management, and cloud integration as well. Today, I'm going to be focusing on the integration aspects of big data. So part of the challenge, if you really look at the big data, two of the attributes is the variety and velocity. So, if we want to get the data, or you actually do any analytics of the big data, you want to be able to get the data from various different sources. And the challenge that typically any organization that runs into is that the organization have to depend on the IT to be able to set up the connection between various different organizations and the sources to be able to pull the data and apply some cleansing logics. That was one of the issues that we heard earlier, is that the quality addresses quality and then be able to bring in the data. But the challenge is that the IT is kind of like the bottleneck. If you want to accomplish a mission, and if IT becomes the bottleneck for various different reasons, because the priorities are different, now you're not able to accomplish the mission. So what we do is that actually we empower the business users to be able to use a product and be able to bring in the data from various different sources. Now, if you look at it, so what there are, if you look at, can all the businesses to be able to solve all of the problems, the integration problems, to be able to build the big data? No, absolutely not. There's going to be something that we can offer to the business user, and there's going to be something that we can offer to the IT user. So, go to the next one. So, what can the business user bring in? Is that the business user have the knowledge about the business processes, what data they're working on, and so when you have a tool which wasn't available in a couple of years ago, when you offer a tool that enables them to be able to apply those business rules and then be able to bring in the data, now that's kind of like the forefront, and that brings in the speed, because what we have heard from what we have run into in the past is that just to set up a connection, it takes anywhere between 2 to 3 months. So when you offer that to the business users, they're able to bring in the data into the door, applying certain rules. It could be the minimum rules to enforce some data quality, but once they bring in, then they can hand off the IT, and the IT takes over and runs with it, you know, to apply like an advanced data processing logic. So with that one, you know, there could be like, you know, two different aspects to it. So one is the front end, the business users that the business user interact with, and there is another aspect to it, which is the heavy lifting of the solution. So which the IT actually takes care, and that's the full scale integration suite that it handles, you know, integration with internal applications or even the external applications. And if you look at, you know, the, is it going to be just the business user or the IT users? Is it going to be catering to everyone? Yes, of course, because there's multiple levels of business users with the different skills, and you know those can all apply different aspects within the tool. So what the business users can actually do is that there are, you know, within the application, you can either build your own connection, or you can use one of the existing connections that are already built into this application. So if you, like we say, you know, one of the connections that we have is the was the interface where the state of Illinois had to get the data from various different agencies to be able to process that tax credit. And you also see like several different connections of that are already pre-built. And you know, the business user can just use those connections and then quickly with other organizations, and then you hand it off to the IT.
Now we're going to launch into the discussion, the panel's discussion segment of it, and we're going to start talking about these challenges that I mentioned earlier. I'm going to start off by raising the issue of the big data talent gap. Now there's a growing community of application developers who are increasing in their knowledge of tools like those that comprise the Hadoop ecosystem. That being said, despite the promotion of these big data technologies, the reality is that there's not a lot of wealth of these skills in the marketplace. The talent gap is real. Let's consider a couple of statistics. McKinsey and Company put out a study 2 years ago that said by 2018, there will be between 140,000 and 190,000 people with deep analytic skills, as well as 1.5 million business managers that have know-how. A Gartner report, however, predicted that by this year, 2015, 4.4 million jobs would be created to support big data, 1.9 million of those jobs here in the United States. So the question is this: how can the talent gap be filled?
I guess I'll start as the academic on the panel. I'm at DePaul University, and over the years, we have had many different courses and individual classes about different aspects of analytics, you know, from model building to databases and so on. But there had never been a coherent package that put together all of the necessary skills to build what nowadays we refer to as data scientists, kind of people who have not just the right kinds of skills at different stages of the process that we were just talking about, but also the ability to kind of understand the problem, you know, propose hypotheses, then drive, you know, arrive at data-driven solutions to those and test those hypotheses and so on. Kind of application of scientific method to data-driven types of problems. And we actually put together a program about in 2009-2010. We were one of the first in the country, a master's degree, we call it in predictive analytics, that's in existence, and you know, some of you may have encountered some of our graduates in the past few years. And I think what we are seeing is that that's really the way to try to address this gap, is to try to have kind of a comprehensive approach to try to build those sort of skills. I'll be happy to talk about that more.
Yeah, we've been hearing like a lot of buzzwords. There's emerging technologies. There are several different technologies that are coming up, and since it's all relatively new, it's very hard to find you know, the appropriate resources in the market. You know, a couple of things I think, you know, you can do. I mean, if you, the risk with not having the upper right resources, that the value that you're going to realize is going to be delayed. You know, the couple of things that you could actually do is that, you know, you can hire, you know, have your own resources. I mean, internal resources, train them. And of course, you know, you're not going to be able to train every one of them. I mean, of course, if you force them, what you're going to find out is that, again, not people are not going to be able to pick them because they're, you know, they don't have the background. So you had to find out who has the right skill sets, at least not that who'll be able to pick it up, and then, you know, who is interested, and based on those interests, you can, you know, have them train. That's one way to address this. And then the second way is actually to get external resources who has some kind of like a background, but not necessarily the technology, but the business background. And you can bring in those resources with the business background and have them train, because those resources, if you look at it, you know, one aspect is to be able to bring in the data and then build the data, and then after that, you know, do the analytics work. So you can have, you know, training, you know, for reasons, you know, people who have like the business background. You know, that's one way to address.
Thank you. Another challenge that we face with trying to put together a big data strategy is understanding how we get data into a big data platform. Now, the scale and variety of data to be absorbed into a big data environment can overwhelm an unprepared data practitioner. Another challenge is data accessibility and integration. The intricate aspects of data access, movement, and loading are only part of the challenge. Extraction and transformation are not limited to structured conventional data sets, but increasingly, analysts want to import old mainframe technology like VSAM files and IMS structures, for example, and at the same time, they want to absorb meaningful representations of objects and concepts, refine out of certain unstructured data types like emails, text, tweets, images, graphics, etc. So the question is, how do we approach the challenge of getting data from these heterogeneous sources into a big data platform?
Yeah, that is one of the biggest challenge of you know, the getting the data, because the data is of a variety of data, and you know, some of them could be structured, some of them could be unstructured. So you know, there are different methodologies to approach this one. So if the data is kind of like in a reasonably structured, but it requires a little bit of a transformation. One way to do it is just to be able to get that data onto Hadoop file system, and then after that, you know, when you actually pull in the data out of the Hadoop file system, then you can apply those minimum transformation. The other is that if you're getting the data, you know, that requires a lot of manipulation, you want to apply some quality checks, transformations. Then you can have like an ETL tool that does it for you. And especially that approach will work if you have like multiple different sources, you know, their data coming in from multiple different sources, and you want to be able to take it into this big data system. So you can apply, you know, that kind of logic. And where it actually helps to be able to integrate much more quicker from all these systems is that you have even like a common interface, like a canonical structure, what we call as a canonical structure, which is like in one format that helps to be able to interface with all those variations in the source system. So then you just convert them into this common format, and then you take the common format and then do a little bit more heavy lifting of the validations, cleanup, you know, transformations before you actually take it into the big data system. So that's another way of approaching that. And I'll also say that, you know, there's a, if you have a system, you know, you don't have to go totally taking a whole new approach to be able to synchronize this data. So what you can do is that, you know, if you have like a database system, RDBMS systems, one of the deficiency of the RDBMS system is that you tend to lose you know the data that you get from the source system, unless it's kind of like in a transformed structure in the way that it can take. What if it can, then you have to lose that data. So what you can do is that you can just pump the data into the RWMS system, and then you can actually, in parallel, take the data to a Hadoop system. And then, you know, you can then do whatever you need to do from the RWMS system, whatever it's built for, and then you can take the rest of the information from the Hadoop system. So that's another way of addressing that. Question?
Public sector has challenges with infrastructure. Typically, there's a mainframe somewhere that we set up is filed all over the place. What are your thoughts on infrastructure planning in terms of planning an infrastructure with the ability to accommodate big data applications?
So, in general, you know, the plan for infrastructure should be that you look at, you know, you start off with the business case. The business case should be the driver, because you can have several different technologies, but you know, if you kind of force the technology into your organization, it may not it may not help you with your mission. In fact, it could actually delay. So what I would say is that start with what the mission is, what the objective is, and then find out appropriate infrastructure plan. So if you have something already within your organization, so one way is to be able to leverage that and look at what the gaps are and then fill those gaps. Now, move towards filling the gaps, there are options to have some on-prem infrastructure. Now, since the advancements of the hardware technology and the storage, it's become relatively cheaper, a lot cheaper to be able to have it in-house. But yet, the things are changing so rapidly, and you could end up with a situation where you might want to go, grow really fast. And if you have that kind of a situation in your project, then you may want to look for, cloud options. The cloud option allows you to be able to either scale up or scale down, depending on your business scenario. So, those are ways to be able to look at it.
So let me add a couple of thoughts from my side from an analytics perspective. You have data from heterogeneous sources. How do we get it into the form?
We have typically seen three challenges.
So we have typically seen three challenges. One is the ability to ingest the data, and it's a huge problem if the volume is
very high.
The second problem is we have to make sure that data is of right quality. Garbage in, garbage out. And as the volume of data goes up, a lot of garbage starts coming in. A lot of sensors that are collecting the data, if something goes wrong, you need to be able to make sure you pick it up front. And the third big problem is, how do you make sense of the data in real time, which is the analytics side. So from an analytics perspective, in addition to getting the data into a platform or infrastructure, there are two other challenges that they need to address, and that is still pretty much evolving. The progress is pretty slow on that, actually.
We should introduce me. I have a very elementary question. It probably is a non-question also. So please forgive my ignorance. When you're giving your presentation, I think you said something about using big data to predict restaurant violations. Yeah. Could you elaborate on that and as to how that would work?
So the question is, how is data analytics and predictive analytics specifically used to figure out restaurant violations? It is not a silver bullet, so you will never say, that guy right there is a problem. You can never say that. But what you could, the city has the responsibility to figure out if the restaurants are in code. The current way of doing it is randomly pick, go, see if things are okay. The handful of people doing that, it's pretty hard when you have 30,000 establishments. So So predictive analytics essentially says, the fundamental question is are there variables that we could use to determine the probability of a code violation being high or low? So for example, if there was a past code violation, or if there was a code violation that happened in the last 1 year, or maybe the last inspection that happened was 10 years ago, then it's, I'm just making things up here, right? I mean, I'm not sure what the exact variables are. But you could essentially use things like that, you know, depending on how crowded it is. You could look at Yelp. You could scan data from the web. If too many people are saying, no good service, place stinks, then chances are there may be a fundamental issue here. So you could use big data, combine it with analytics, and figure out the higher probability of violation.
I eat out a lot, so that was...
So again, I'm from the government sector, and a couple of things I guess I'm not hearing that I think are important. One of the issues, again, is data quality. If you're in government, I mean, there's a lot of things that go wrong with data quality, and they're complex. I could go on it, I won't. But I think without addressing that, you've got some serious problems, because once the data enters the system, it's not going to circulate. So the number of errors you have is going to, not only is it going to be held, it's not static. As information circulates around, the errors circulate around. And I think it's a big question, how do you guarantee the quality and the integrity of the data? I don't think it's a simple question, but I think it's one that needs to be addressed. The other issue, I guess, that I'm hearing, and it's not real clear to me, but in general, with government, you're not just trying to do one thing. It's nice to say, here's the application we want. Let's go do our requirements, figure out where we get the data. That's really nice. You've now done it for one application. In government, you've got hundreds. And one of the problems, which I've seen all the time, is a particular application ends up structuring data in a way that everyone else who needs to use it becomes problematic, if not impossible to deal with. So the idea of looking at things from a specific kind of utilitarian point of view, I think, has also become a mistake. And we need to have some way of conceptualizing all the data we're pulling in, all the different ways it may be used, and especially the ways we haven't thought about that somebody's going to ask for. Those are really complicated issues. And what I'm seeing right now a lot is these questions are being ignored. People are grinding things out. And the quality of what's being ground out is questionable. And therefore, the return on the investment becomes questionable. And I think those are big challenges that I, you know, I'd like to hear people. I don't expect answers, but I would like to hear some people addressing that.
Actually, Ivan, that's a great segue into my next question. And we weren't going to be able to flush out all the challenges, but that one of data quality is obviously a major one, which leads me to my next question. Given the fact that, given the business impacts of these challenges, they suggest that there's certain risk. And there's serious risk. What risk do these challenges actually impose? Ivan mentioned data quality, the risks are obvious there. But let's open it up a little bit in terms of the challenges that we've identified.
I guess I'll start with your last point that you were making, and go back to one of the slides that. Yes, the last one. Yep. So I think you were talking about, you have lots of different applications. The question is, do you need really different kinds of platforms or infrastructure for each type of an application? And I think the answer to that is both yes and no, right? I mean, if you are trying to bring in lots of different data sources, let's say, you know, you would bring in Yelp review data in order to be able to make some kind of a prediction later on for some particular application. Some of that can be done across applications, right? So you could bring in a lot of this data. Platforms like Hadoop, for example, allow us to do that in a nice way, open source and so on. And that data then can be structured or processed and cleaned within that kind of a Hadoop infrastructure and be available for lots of different applications. The part that you get into for finding specific type of applications is where you're doing the modeling, because you need different kinds of modeling for different types of applications. If you want to make a prediction about the restaurants, you know, that's a different kind of application than if you want to do customer segmentation, let's say in a particular product, for example. So that's where this near-mind thing comes in. And then, of course, you know, the most application-dependent and domain-dependent is the personalization or the real-time kind of decisions, because that requires knowing, you know, what context you're giving the recommendation. You need to do additional kinds of filtering.
So I think if you think about it in
these terms, that might provide a kind of a guideline about how to draw those lines.
So to Ivan's point and to Rich's question, what are some of the big challenges in big data and analytics? And you're absolutely correct. The quality of data usually gets overlooked. In the hurry to dig for gold, you dig a lot of dirt. And you're not sure what is gold, so you store everything. But by the time you figure out it is dirt, it is too late. It's being used for something else, alchemy. As an example, when we go into a client and we do a project, what we see is that over 50%, 50 to 60% of the time that we actually spend is in cleaning up and harmonizing the data. So more than that, yeah. So data quality is of multiple issues here. One particular client I remember, they were storing, let's say, you know, Coca-Cola. Somebody's entering it as a six-pack of Coke in the store, but in the warehouse it is being used, is being stored as, you know, how many liters of Coke do I have? So everybody has units talking about the same thing. Is the quality of data incorrect? The data is also not harmonized. So that's one of the big challenges that we will have to overcome. Otherwise, in our rush to collect all data, we'll have no idea what we're sitting on. That's a bigger risk. And many times, fixing the problem takes a lot more money than fixing it as soon as you get it.
Yeah, I'd like to add a couple more points said as well. So data quality is a very key issue. Sometimes the data is being referenced like in different ways. It could be the same exact data, but it could be referenced in different ways. Sometimes the data is not the most recent, it's expired, it's no more valid data. Sometimes the data is there, but it's not the most recent version of the data, because there are other versions of the data. It's been overwritten and it's not applicable anymore. So there are a number of ways like the data could be incorrect. And I think one of the best ways into what the other panelists said is this, to have like a data governance approach. Having a data governance approach will emphasize how the data is structured, how it's been created, how it's been pulled into the systems. You know, what kind of validations do we apply? How do we synchronize them? So by having a data dictionary, so that you're not referencing the data in like in multiple different ways that causes confusion, and eventually, sometimes it could be out of sync when you represent the same data in a multiple different ways. So to have a data governance policy and enforce it across within the organization and for all the applications, and having common dictionary and enforcing those rules to be able to clean the data before even it gets into the system. But if it does get into the system, again, have another layer to be able to apply certain cleanup logics to be able to clean that. And then so for going forward, it'll all be the most leaders and the cleanest one possible.
Thank you. And Krishna, you've given us another segue when we talk about governance. That leads me to the types of questions that an agency head or a department head or a CIO or CFO, what are the questions they should be thinking about when developing a big data strategy?
The first crack at that. I think one of the things that often we don't talk about here is, do you even need a big data strategy? In other words, Is there something you can do with big data that you cannot do with small data, right? And the answer in a lot of cases actually is no. And so one of the risks that we were talking about is actually creating more and introducing more complexity where it's not needed. And there are applications like some of the examples we were looking at where it does make sense to bring in data from other sources, unstructured data, big data, that could potentially shed light and be able to allow you to create more predictive models. But there are a lot of other situations, particularly internal to organizations, that don't necessarily require Hadoop.
They don't
require some of these big infrastructures. And so, I mean, that's one of the first decisions you have to make. And that, by the way, is a very tough question to answer for a lot of people, right? Do you need big data? I mean, can you do something with big data that you cannot do with small data? And I think Jeff, in his talk, his approach was to try to present people with some of those options and to try to get them to answer that question. And I think, but that's the first critical question to ask.
So one of the questions that you may want to find out is that, so once you determine, so obviously the technology is supposed to solve the problem, not create the problem in itself. So once, if you have the right justification to go with the big data, then the next thing is to find out, do you have the right infrastructure? I think that was the question. Do we have the right infrastructure to begin with? And where are the gaps? And the idea, again, like I said earlier, is to not go acquire all the new technologies and add it to it. So find out, based on what the business case, what's the right approach to be able to create this infrastructure. Even within the infrastructure, what is the right approach to be able to even model the data? There are many different options. Not every option is going to address every business problem. So you have to pick the right one. Could be like, from a technical term, so it could be document styles, key value pair styles, or graph styles. So you had to pick the right one that actually addresses your business problem. So that's the next question to ask, is to figure out what is the right infrastructure for the mission that you're taking, and do you have the one, and then figure out what the gaps are, either by filling in on-prem or otherwise go to cloud. That could be at the hardware level, software level, and network level as well.
So what are the key questions to ask when thinking about big data strategy? Big data is a means to an end. So the first question to ask is, what is the end? The end is usually, a lot of it depends on analytics. What do I want to do? If the end was, I want to figure out which electrical manholes are going to have fires, then I'm going to use it differently. But the first question, the way I would think about strategy is, don't boil the ocean. You just can't do it. Take a small problem, see if you can solve it, and then it's a lot easier to start collecting more data and sell it internally to the organization. And that's how we sell it to our clients. If you try to jump in too fast, too big, that's just too much. Take it small.
Thank you. I think we want to move into the analytics realm now, and I'm going to pose a couple of questions in that area. And I don't want to direct this at any one particular person, but I think I know the one I want to comment on first, and that is, what are the key upfront requirements for a successful analytics program?
Key upfront requirements kind of segues into the previous question. We first want to know what we're trying to solve. So that is number one. And number two, what we have found is when somebody high up buys in into what you want to do, things move a lot easier because invariably the data is in multiple places within an organization and a lot of people have to agree to give you access to that data. So it makes it a lot easier when somebody high up says, yeah, let's go do it. So know what you're trying to solve and make sure that is a problem that is worth solving. It's something that concerns a lot of people because analytics will give you a very high return on investment. There was a recent article, a market research, where it was found that for every dollar invested in analytics, the return in 2011 or 2012 was $11 for every dollar. And by 2013, 2014, that had gone up to $13.05. So for every dollar, you get $13.05. So make sure you pick big problems that you want to solve, and you'll have the right support going behind it.
Thank you for that, sir. Can you share some examples where companies have successfully used data in many different sources to create insights?
Have companies used external data to create insights? I can think of quite a few examples, and one very interesting manufacturing company comes to mind. We were working with a fertilizer manufacturer, and they were trying to predict demand of the fertilizers 4 months ahead of time so they could optimize their supply chain and manufacturing. And using the regular ERP systems, they were getting an accuracy of 50%. So when we went in, we piggybacked on their existing systems and we brought in external data relevant to the future prediction. Things like weather forecasts, the price of grains in the future, how is the competitor doing this year, what is the local GDP in that place, and so on and so forth. So when we were able to bring in a lot of external data, our prediction for our accuracy went up to 70%, and in some cases up to even 80%. So external, a lot of data is available that is very rich, very valuable outside the organization. No organization has the entire set of data. And the sooner most of them realize it, they benefit a lot more. We can mine social media, we can get a lot of external data. Government has lots of data and lots of other sources. And we can create a lot more value combining it with an organization's internal data.
Just one other example I would like to add is the health service. So if you know the government agency can collect information from various different sources, the insurance, the hospitals, the doctors, individual health provider service, and then to be able to collect the data and then see what the patterns, the trends in the regarding the health concerns. So if there are any trend on certain aspects of disease spreading out or in a certain region, that could be addressed with collecting all the information from various different sources and analyzing the data and provide a solution to that as well.
You just add to that from the more of a business consumer perspective. There are some good examples of big data success, I think, that we have seen. And many of you are probably familiar with companies like Google, right? Netflix, Amazon. And these companies, I think, getting back to what I was talking about earlier, analytics and the use of big data is really driving the next generation of the intelligent tools that they're providing. Amazon, for example, more than 35% of the sales come from recommendations that are generated based on the predictions that are made. Netflix, 45% of sales or of interaction with the customers comes from these recommendations. If you look at a company like Facebook, 95% of the interactions with users come from these personalized feeds. And these also drive, of course, the business model of these companies that allows them to do more targeting and sell advertising and so on. And I think those are some good examples. Facebook, for example, the data that they use is not just you know, based on the user interactions and click-throughs. They also use the social network data, you know, that's generated, and mining that allows them to be able to do the kinds of predictions and recommendations that they give, and so on. So that's a good example of situations where big data is necessary in order to actually achieve the kinds of predictions that they are trying to make. You need that large graph structure of you know, the social network to be able to make those kinds of predictions. Similarly about Google, for example, and so on.
I think we have just enough time before questions to ask two more questions. As new devices and technologies such as cell phones and social media are creating new sources of data, how can governments leverage that?
So, you know, the information, I mean, I think, you know, now, that in the past, the sourcing the data has been a big challenge. And, you know, where the information was sourced for a specific reason, to kind of, like, you know, figure out, certain, apply a solution, provide a solution, you know, for a certain business functions. Or it could be to find out, you know, what has happened in the past, rather than providing a futuristic solution. So when it comes to, like, a, you know, the devices that used by all these users, it's even more easier to be able to get this information directly from the end users. And, you know, that could be used for providing several different, you know, services, you know, improve the current existing services that the governments provide and improve on it. It could be to figure out in driver's applications, like we said, so in the past for health applications or tax benefits. So the information can be collected for various different purposes from all these kind of like devices and be able to provide, improve the services that the government provides, and, you know, to reduce the tax dollars as well.
So how can new devices and technologies be used by the government? We are living, or rather going into the age of the Internet of Things. So a lot of things around us are collecting data. I think when New York City had the Super Bowl, what they had done was they had installed these little things called beacons throughout the city, throughout Manhattan. So when somebody with an NFL app would walk in, the beacon would essentially be able to interact with their cell phone, and the cell phone ultimately with the NFL servers, and they could send customized messages saying, hey, by the way, you're right here, there is, there's something that's related to NFL that's happening two blocks down. So that's a great example of how things around us are beginning to interact with us. We can have similar beacons installed in the example we were talking about earlier. The sewer management in Philadelphia. So you could have sensors in places around us which can help the government collect a lot more data to help us to make things a lot more efficient.
One quick thing to add from sort of the other end of the spectrum is not so much about the data that users generate and send out someplace, but the data that comes in to these small devices. And I think that's also a good example of what you're talking about today. So if you think about what would be a good kind of a restaurant recommender system on your phone, right? You want to be able to get the right restaurant recommendation on your phone at the right time, in the right place. You want it to be able to distinguish between, let's say, whether you're on a business lunch or you're going on a romantic outing with your spouse. You want to be able to take into account whether you did the reviews for the restaurants, and of course your past preferences for food. There is a lot of stuff that's going into that to try to build that kind of a predictive model for that user and then serve it at the right time. Furthermore, you can't just generate, 100 recommendations for the users to scroll through. It has to be, you know, two or three things that fit on one screen on your mobile app, and it has to be at the right time. So you're talking about, in addition to all of the modeling, an ability to have a type of context awareness. And this is getting, you know, I'm putting a plug for the kind of research that I do at DePaul, but, you know, that's one of the, I think, critical elements in being able to derive specifically the kinds of targeting we're talking about.
Thank you, Helen. This will be the last question before we open up the floor. What are the architectural trends for integrating with external data vendors and service providers for big data projects?
So one of the architecture that's been followed, Wally, is that the schema to write, but you know that is dependent on the traditional RDBMS structure, which, where you have to define exactly the data structures and how you're going to be able to bring in. And as long as you want the asset properties, then that works. But you know, the other architecture trend is that the Lambda architecture, which has like a multiple different layers. One layer to actually cater to the real-time receiving of the data. So that could be through GMS or any other means to be able to get the data rapidly into the big data system. The other layer services the batch-oriented data receiving. And then, you know, the one, so it addresses the both sides of the real-time data ingestion into the data warehouse, I mean, the big data system, could be Hadoop, or also the batch system, right? And then the other layer, the third layer to this whole infra model is that the servicing layer. The servicing layer allows the user to be able to view the data that's gotten into the system either through real-time or through batch program in the way that they want to do. They can run queries, they can have like an interface on top of it to be able to pull in the data based on applying certain analytics. So that's one way to approach it.
That's going to conclude the discussion portion of that, and we're going to open up the floor for questions.
It will take only a couple of questions. Anyone?
All right, so she has one. I know you've been talking about strategy related to big data, and I'm just wondering what your opinion is about some of the big data maturity models from Warehouse Institute, Management Science, International Institute for Analytics. Do you think this offers good guidance for organizations here starting out and maturing through their journey on big data?
Yeah, so the question, you may want to clarify a little bit. It was a long one.
Yeah, there are a number of organizations that have proposed maturity models starting out with small projects, adding in, you know, governance as you go along, and you get enterprise-wide analytics projects. Is this, are these models something that individuals here would benefit from in looking at the growth from small projects and big data to very large-scale integrated enterprise projects?
It seemed like an yes or no question, and the answer is yes. Very correct. Start with small projects, and then it's impossible to predict what your needs are going to be and how you're going to be using big data. So when we work with clients on analytic projects, that's how we start off with. Let's take a problem we know that's worth solving and let's solve it. And then let's figure out, as we move further along, what are the other things to do. So that's the maturity model that you're talking about. Take small and then keep moving fast.
Yeah, just to add a little bit to what Seth said as well, I can give you an example. One online cars company receives the information from various different sources. It could be dealers, and it could be from all the other portals where users are providing their opinion about the cars. And So in the past, what they used to do is that, you know, do it as like a batch process, overnight batch process. They used to get the data from the dealers, and they used to get the data from like various other sources, and then process them overnight, and then feed that into the RDMS system, and then run the report to find out the user behavior. But you know, since the advent of new technology, the big data technologies, what they've been able to do is that they not only be able to take that data, the data from the dealers and various other sources, but in a much more rapid way. So instead of taking like, you know, several hours to be able to receive and process it, they were able to actually load the data into the system within an hour. So once the data is loaded into Hadoop, then you know they're able to apply certain applications to be able to pull the necessary data to be able to see and figure out the user's behavior, whether the user actually saw clicked on a car's information because they saw a banner, and prior to that, did the user come in to the website? You know, in the past, it could be a couple of days before or a couple of weeks before, but why did they not see the information about the car? And it's probably because, you know, there was a banner ad right in front of it, so saying that, okay, promoting this particular car product. So, you know, they have been able to see that, you know, with a small application. And then, you know, once they saw the benefit of this one, so they were able to move on to, you know, the rest of all the digital functions. So that would, I would say that, you know, startup, I mean, there are several different technologies, not all of them has matured enough to be able to service by itself. It's going to be a combination of multiple different technologies, but start off with the small and then see the success, and then you'll learn lessons from it, and then you can grow out of it.
We'll take one last question.
How you doing? General question, I guess, as it relates to government, our governments have been around for a long time, it's probably safe to say that, and most of our government agencies, if not all of them, provide services that are free or human rights, and they're not just a department. I mean, they're separate agencies who are trying to integrate data. So what's the Sesame Street business case for a government to whose infrastructure is probably not gonna be normalized, or, you know, the term legacy, is that those systems are gonna exist for a long time. So what's the Sesame Street business case for government officials to be considering big data?
You got $1 million to answer that question.
So,
Sesame Street, I mean, simple.
Absolutely.
It has to be simple.
So, if the government were to adopt
big data strategies,
what are the two or three big problems they should think about first? Easy ones. Is that a fair summary of your question?
Sure.
All right. What IBM says, IBM has worked quite a bit with a lot of governments, is the key request that they get from governments on how to use big data is, number one, traffic management, and number two, water management. How do we decongest the cities, and how do we make sure, you know, we don't waste water, or we are treating it right before we get it out? It seems like a pretty simple non-data problem. Pretty much anything is a data problem. You can make it a lot more efficient. Reduce your cost of what you're already doing. So those are some of the two biggest things. You can also add health and human services and other infrastructure projects that cities could do, which are low-hanging fruits.
Just one thing to add, maybe generalize that. I think the two big areas where government in general, maybe government agencies, could use predictive analytics. One is in resource management. I think that traffic issue is one of those. Also predicting, for example, where you need resources at the right time. That's kind of a prediction problem. You know, if you know Lollapalooza happens every year, you know, at a certain time, you know that you have to moving resources, you know, police department, fire department, paramedics, etc., in certain areas. But, you know, across the city or across maybe the United States, there are lots of different situations where you don't necessarily know all of these things, but you can make some good predictions. And other areas actually providing targeted services to users, to people. So services sometimes provided at, you know, aggregate level at different areas or different domains, but you can actually personalize this more if you can build more predictive models at the individual level.
So one other example that I can think of is that I think it was mentioned in the beginning as well. So in the prison, if you were to look at, you know, why the prisoner is there. You know, identifying the root causes, and then is it more likely that the person can come back for any other reasons in the future? So identifying that information about, you know, where, what causes them to come into jail, and where actually they start, and how do they behave within when they are in the prison, helps the government to be able to figure out, you know, what the root cause is, and then address the root cause so that, you know, the cost of having them in the prison can be reduced or eliminated.
All right, so what a fantastic panel. Round of applause, folks. So this time, I'm going to introduce to you back the two ladies, the two builders, Ellen and Puna, to come on the stage here.
So instrumental in helping us put this whole symposium together. We're so grateful to you. Thank you so much for doing that. And thank you, gentlemen. We really appreciate you.
Well, you can make a point, look at me and Ellen, such a coordinated team, color-wise at least. I would like to invite Dr. Jim Chalvin, a co-founder of GTL, to help us give a little appreciation to the team who has gotten the knowledge together with us. And the request is move away from the light. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Yes. Some new stuff, some new thoughts.
Yeah, good one, yeah?